It's being called an unprecedented mystery. And there's still far more questions than answers surrounding the disappearance of that Malaysian Airlines flight this weekend.
Experts are looking into every possibility, including terrorism. Ephraim Graham has the story.
The U.S. Navy has now joined international search and rescue teams in the hunt for wreckage of the missing Malaysia Airlines passenger jet. But ships have recovered nothing. Experts say the Boeing 777 has an excellent safety record, and they found no problems with the plane when it was inspected just about 10 days before the crash. Still, they lost contact with ground controllers somewhere between Malaysia and Vietnam, with 239 people on board. And among the missing passengers is American Philip Wood. His family says their faith in Christ is what's holding them together.
It's devastating. But I know in my heart that Philip's with God, and I plan to be there with him because I have a deep faith in my God.
The flight was headed from Kuala Lumpur to Beijing, and Malaysian authorities say radar suggests it may have been turning around before it vanished. But there was no mayday call.
That is a really, really safe place to be, which makes this mystery all that much deeper.
And officials are investigating the possibility of terrorism. Malaysian authorities have reportedly identified one of the two passengers who boarded the jet with a stolen passport. They haven't named the passenger, but say it was someone from outside Malaysia. The identification came as officials have been scouring surveillance footage for those two passengers. The FBI and U.S. intelligence agencies also want to see that video, hoping for clues to solve what so far has been a great mystery. Ephraim Graham, CBN News.
Well, our CBN News terrorism analyst Eric Steckelbeck is with us. Eric, what is it about Malaysia? I've never thought of that as a breeding ground for terrorism, or is it?
Yeah, Pat, I wouldn't call it a breeding ground, but remember, this is a Muslim-majority country, and any potential terrorist, Pat, could find a support network on the ground there. A few things to know about Malaysia. Number one, some of the 9/11 hijackers, Pat, passed through that country. That's the main thing to know about Malaysia. Also, back in the mid-90s, Pat, Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, who was the mastermind of the 9/11 attacks, he put together a nasty, nasty plot planning to hijack 11 transatlantic airliners out of Southeast Asia, around where Malaysia is located. Also, Pat, another wrinkle here in that region, China. In Western China, there is a separatist movement right now, Pat, a group called the Uyghurs. They are a Muslim group in Western China. They want to break away from China, form their own Islamic State. We've seen them carry out several attacks over the past few months. Even last week, Pat, 27 people were killed in China after an attack from these Uyghurs. This plane was going from Malaysia to China. Now, were the Uyghurs involved? We don't know. We don't even know if it was terrorism, but definitely a lot of questions mark here, and a lot of smoke here, too.
Eric, usually if something goes down the middle of a flight, you see some explosion. It would show up on a radar screen. They apparently didn't have any explosion. It just vanished.
Yeah, Pat, just sudden, you know. And you think about it, okay, if there was a bomb to go off on the plane, if a bomb rips through a plane, Pat, at that high altitude, 35,000 feet, the plane's going to break in pieces. It's going to be sudden and dramatic. And when we talk about the possibility of terrorism here, Pat, look at the past few months, even the past few weeks. We've had several warnings from the Department of Homeland Security to look for, number one, toothpaste tube bombers aboard planes. Number two, shoe bombers, once again, aboard planes. Did we see something here, Pat? You know, you think about Southeast Asia, some of these airports, maybe the airline security isn't as tight as it here in, as it is here in the West. Maybe Al-Qaeda is probing. Maybe they're conducting dry runs. Maybe they're saying, hey, we have a new strategy, a new technique. Let's try it out in Southeast Asia and then bring it here to the West. I hope not, but that is a possibility.
Clarify for us that missing passport scenario. Somebody didn't have a passport, or they left a passport, or they boarded without a passport. What was the story on that?
Two people, Pat, apparently boarded this flight bound from Malaysia to China with stolen passports. Now, one of the passports was from an Austrian citizen, one from an Italian citizen. We don't know who these guys were who used these stolen passports, Pat. Apparently, Malaysian authorities have identified one of them. They were not Malaysian, apparently, which is a red flag. And anytime you have stolen passports, Pat, look, it's a red flag. Now, you could use stolen passports if you're a drug mule, if you're involved in drug running, other kinds of illegal activity. But many times, terrorists have used stolen passports to get through security and get on airplanes. And you know, Pat, with this threat to airplanes, to the aviation system, it's not going to stop. This is the holy grail for Islamic terrorists. You can cause so much carnage through airplanes, Pat, whether it's economic, hurting the airline industry, psychological, and physical. Think of 9/11, what a few planes did, Pat, killed over 3,000 people. So these terrorists will continue to try to hijack planes. That is their holy grail at the end of the day.
Eric, thank you very much. Eric Stackelbeck, ladies and gentlemen. Well, here at home, the big names in the Republican Party came to the Conservative Political Action Conference this past weekend. As expected, they blasted President Obama and liberal Democrats in Congress, and they offered their own solutions for America. Our David Brody was there.
The fiery rhetoric was hot all weekend long.
We need to repeal every single word of Obamacare.
Some conservative presidential wannabes, like Texas Governor Rick Perry, said it's time to start a rebellion. Mike Huckabee was concerned about God's fiery judgment coming down on America if we forget about the Creator. And some, like Louisiana Governor Bobby Jindal, had a few punchlines.
To President Carter, I want to issue a sincere apology. It is no longer fair to say he was the worst president of this great country in my lifetime. President Obama has proven me wrong.
After the speech, the governor and possible presidential candidate told us that this president's policies are helping the conservative cause.
The failures of the execution and the design of Obamacare may be the best argument against progressivism we're ever going to see. I think people are now beginning to see it doesn't make sense just to trust the government to do everything for us. It doesn't work. We need to trust the founding fathers were right to trust the American people, not a bunch of guys in D.C.
And conservatives like possible presidential candidate Paul Ryan were wasting no time bashing big government in Washington.
Right now, the tax code is 10 times the size of the Bible and has none of the good news.
But critics say the news is not good for Republicans because of supposed infighting over how conservative the movement should be. Ryan sees it differently.
The way the left tells it, the Republican Party is in this big, massive civil war. It's Tea Party versus establishment, libertarians versus social conservatives. There's infighting, conflict, backbiting, discord. Look, I'm Irish. That's my idea of a family reunion.
But all eyes were on New Jersey governor and possible presidential contender Chris Christie. Some conservatives think his record is too moderate. He wasn't invited to CPAC last year. But this year, he was well-received, and he played up his social conservative record.
When we say that we're pro-life and that we're proudly pro-life, that doesn't mean we're pro-life just when that human being is in the womb. We need to be pro-life when they leave the womb as well.
After his speech, Christie told us he was glad to be back.
You know, we have a lot in common in terms of what my record has been. And so I felt the reception was great, and I look forward to coming back next year if I'm invited.
Christie's focus is on something conservatives are well aware of, broadening the scope of the party and coming across as more compassionate.
Our ideas are better than their ideas. And if we put them forward in an unapologetic, straight way, we can do it. But also, Dave, we've got to go into places and campaign in places where we're uncomfortable. We can't just keep going to the Chamber of Commerce luncheons, and we can't just keep coming to CPAC. We've got to go into Latino neighborhoods. We have to go into African-American neighborhoods.
While this conference gives conservatives the opportunity to galvanize with what they hope will be a successful midterm election season, it doesn't resolve the larger issue, and that is whether or not to be a big tent of a party or stick to those constitutional conservative principles. David Brody, CBN News, in National Harbor, Maryland.
Wow. Well, that's a small group, and they have gotten a lot of publicity. I don't know how effective it's going to be.
But well, they had a lot of wonderful speakers there. Interesting to see where that all falls.
And the man from Kentucky won the straw poll.
We'll see where that lands,
yeah,
right?
We'll see where that lands.
Steve Hill, the evangelist associated with the Brownsville Revival, has died. Hill fought a long battle with cancer and succumbed to the disease Sunday at his home in Alabama. He's best known as one of the leaders of a revival that began on Father's Day, 1995, at Brownsville Assembly of God in Pensacola, Florida. Church leaders said, quote, a, quote, mighty wind of God's power blew through the service that day, and it sparked a five-year revival. An estimated 4 million people from 150 nations reportedly came to the services, sharing stories of deliverance from drug and alcohol addictions and receiving a fresh desire to preach God's word. Steve Hill was 60 years old. CBN is providing food to struggling families and orphans in Romania. Each month, CBN sponsors a refrigerated truck with donated food. It travels more than 600 miles from Germany to Western Romania. Once there, volunteers help sort out and distribute food to families in need and to a local orphanage. More than a quarter of a million of the population makes less than $2 an hour, so struggling families are grateful for the food. CBN also gives out shoes and clothing to help hundreds of people during the winter, cold winter. You can find out more about what CBN is doing around the world by logging on to cbn.com/international.